Welcome to the service of worship in Haddonfield United Methodist Church. I'm so grateful for each of you to join us to worship our God who gives us a new beginning each season. Have you tried something recently to improve yourself, like taking a class or hiring a coach? Sermon on the Mountain is Jesus' teaching, profound teaching for his disciples, inviting them to follow him. So today, Pastor Chris will start the message about the kingdom of God as we follow Jesus as a faithful disciples. So I hope and I pray for you, God blesses our heart as we worship together. Let's get started.
Good morning, Haddonfield United Methodist Church. It is a beautiful day and the Lord reigns over it. As we gather together to worship, we recognize just how blessed we are as we begin a new sermon series on the Sermon on the Mount. So let us join together, lift our voices, and rise up as we sing together, Rise.
Your goodness.
One day there'll be no more waiting left for our souls. One day there'll be no more children longing for home. One day when the kingdom comes right here where we stand, we will see the promised land. One day there'll be no more lives taken too soon. One day there'll be no more need for a hospital room. One day every tear that falls will be wiped by His hand, and we will see the promised land. Skin won't cause a divide. One day we'll be family standing hand in hand, and we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land. Hallelujah! There will be healing from this heartbreak we've been feeling. We'll sing in the darkest night, we know that the light. One day when our tired and weary bones find their rest. One day when the power of evil is brought to an end, we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land.
Hallelujah! There will be healing from His heart.
Today we're going to talk about perspective. For this experiment, you're going to need cardstock, but we used paper plates, a ruler, hole punch, scissors, some string, and we also had a crayon and a pen. So you're gonna cut out a circle about 4 inches, and on one side, you're going to draw a fishbowl, and on the other side, you're going to draw a fish. You're going to then use your hole punch to punch 2 holes in the top and 2 holes in the bottom. You're going to then use string, and we'll show you what it does with that later. And it's about 24 inches long. After you've looped it around, what you're gonna do is spin this around. You can count how many times, but you're just gonna keep on spinning it until it gets tight.
Yep.
Okay, now that you've spun it, we're gonna let it go. I'm gonna give a little push. Here, let's try it this way. Ooh! Now, sometimes when we look around, we see things like rain, and we think that it's going to ruin our day. We can't go out and play, we can't go to the beach. But if we take a step back, we see what rain does. It helps the grass grow, it gives us water to drink, plants can grow that we'll end up eating, so rain is not necessarily a bad thing. It lets the grass grow that we can play on. Sometimes things happen that may be difficult or sad. So, if we change our perspective, we can actually see things that are different. We can see that God loves us through actions of other people and in blessings every day. This week, take some time to look around, keep an open mind and an open heart to find the simple blessings that are around you, and maybe change your perspective.
Yep.
Thanks so much. Try this experiment with your family, and we'll see you next week.
Bye.
Bye.
We want to meet where you are. And whether you're comfortable for online services or outdoor services, each of you is so, so important to God and to us. And we want to offer various services for you. First of all, we continue to offer two online services on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock and 10:30. And especially for these both online services, you can join phone live streaming as well by dialing in 856-213-2015. And also, in-person outdoor service is offered today at 10 o'clock in the North Lawn at the church. All are welcome. And please know that your safety is our priority. So please keep social distancing and wearing masks at all times. And Children's Sunday School starts today, virtually at 10 o'clock from pre-K to 5th grade. And youth group resumes their meeting outdoor at 6:30 in this evening. So if you need more information about children's ministry or youth ministry, please visit our website at haddonfieldumc.org. A small group is a place of mutual learning, fellowship, and deep growth in faith. And our goal is to create the meaningful connections, meaningful spaces for you, as many as possible. So we offer connect groups meeting at various times with the connect guide following the weekly sermon theme. And also, you can find various study groups to go deeper in your faith. Especially in this fall, we newly launched a faithful family group for the parents with young children to support each other in raising and nurturing children in the faith. So please do not hesitate to contact me if you are interested in or need more information. Thank you so much for your generous giving and sharing your resources with us as an expression of your gratitude to God. We are privileged to be partnering with you as we deliver the good news and keep planting the seed of love and hope in the places where it's needed. So you can continue to drop off food items at our church breezeway anytime. And you can continue to give online or mail a check to the church office.
Good morning. Our passage today is from Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteous' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Learn from the best. That's what Masterclass ads invite us to do. For a nominal fee each year, a person can take hundreds of classes from people who are giants in their field, like Learn Photography from Annie Leibovitz, or cooking from Dave Ramsey, guitar from Carlos Santana, comedy from Steve Martin, even learn filmmaking from someone like Martin Scorsese. Who wouldn't want to study with a giant in the field? In the last few months, while people have been quarantined at home, I've seen things like this, subscription services for guitar lessons and voice lessons and coaching sessions have just blown up my Facebook feed and my email inbox. While people are not able to go out and teach and speak, they're finding digital media as a way to connect with new audiences for a small fee. The question I ask myself as I see all of these advertisements, it's, well, there's so much free content out there. I can watch speeches and lectures and demos and sermons and classes for free on YouTube and Vimeo and other places. Why would I pay up to hundreds of dollars for such a class like this? And I think the appeal is that for a paid service, a master class is where you get the insider information, the stuff that's better than what's out there for free, tricks of the trade, the secrets that a person holds close. And particularly with the masterclass service, how can you be learning from some of the best people in their field, their own stories, and to get an insider's look of how it's done? A masterclass is where we get to see the real content that can help us go from good to great. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapters 5, 6, and 7, we have the best example of what could be considered a master class by Jesus. It is where he shares the good stuff, the inside information about God's reign here on earth. This is a sermon, often referred to as the Sermon on the Mount, sermon or lecture or the rabbi's greatest hits, however you want to look at it, in which Jesus is not speaking to the masses. It's not a free lecture out there on YouTube, but this is an intimate conversation in which Jesus is taking his newly recruited students. Only four so far have been named in the Gospel of Matthew who joined Jesus' tutelage. But what we know is the new disciples gather with him on the side of this hill or mountain, and he begins to teach them. Now, these instructions are, again, not just speeches that he puts out there for anyone, or they're not platitudes or generalities. They are specific instructions for people who are committing their life to follow him. He is speaking not to everyone, but to those who have committed to learning from and following him. Knowing that I would be preaching for 6 weeks on the Sermon on the Mount, I've spent a couple months reading it, looking at it in different translations, listening to it, looking at the Sermon on the Mount in different languages. And believe it or not, one day I was riding my bike and I was listening on Audible to Martin Luther's translation in German. I was listening to the Sermon on the Mount in German. And it began, and something caught my attention, something I had not really heard before. It said in German that after Jesus had climbed the hill and saw the crowds and went away with his disciples, it says, "Er tat sich sein Mund auf und lehrte," which literally means he opened his mouth and taught. I thought, Mund, mouth, it doesn't say anything about Jesus' mouth. Sure enough, when I went back home, I looked in English. None of the English translations that I use say anything about Jesus' mouth, just as he went up the hill and taught. So I looked at the Greek, found an interlinear Greek Bible, and looked, and sure enough, the word in Greek, mouth, appears. Well, what's the significance of that? I think in today's day and age, where so many people speculate or claim to know what Jesus would do or what Jesus would think, or where people argue as to what the right course to follow Israel, or the church and Christians are divided over issues, political and moral and other issues, we always wonder who is right if this part of Scripture says this and we don't know the right interpretation. This is one passage that we don't have to wonder about. For three chapters, Jesus does nothing but speak. There are no miracles, there's no traveling. It comes straight from his mouth. This master class is not for the faint of heart. Later in the sermon, Jesus says, if you want to be my disciple, if you want to be a part of this new family, you will do what I say. There will be some who say, Lord, Lord, but I will say, I do not know you. For Jesus, it's not just about hearing these words, but it's about putting them into practice and following Jesus. Well, let's take a look at how he opens his master class. Jesus begins what we call the Beatitudes, which is a series of nine blessings. Beatitudes, think of the word beatify, means to glorify or praise or to bless. Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, blessed has a religious connotation for us in English, but this is not the blessed, like, blessed are you, God. The most modern Jewish prayers today begin with the words, Baruch atah Adonai, blessed are you, Lord. Jesus did not say the word Baruch. This is not a holy blessing. He used the word in Aramaic that comes from the Hebrew word Ashrei, which means fortunate or happy. Happy are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, it's hard to use that word happy, particularly when we get into the second beatitude, when Jesus talks about those who mourn. Happy are those who mourn? That doesn't make any sense. Ashrei, or blessed, implies that for each of these nine blessings, in God's kingdom, in God's reign, there is an inherent gift. Jesus is not romanticizing poverty. He's not saying, oh, the poor are happy, or those who weep are happy. But Jesus is saying that in their human plight, where the world may see people as cursed, cursed by loss, or cursed by low state, God sees blessing and there is an inherent gift. Now, the term poor in spirit has been debated for millennia. It's not blessed are the poor, but blessed are the poor in spirit, meaning literally those who empty themselves of pride and the need to possess power. Blessed are those who, no matter how good they are, do not lift themselves above others. Now, while Jesus reserves blessed are the meek for a few verses later, there is a similarity in these two lines, where Jesus is saying, you, my followers, you will find a gift if you can humble yourself and not think of yourself as better than the widow or the orphan or those who are sick or those who are poor. Yours will be the kingdom of heaven. Later in the sermon, Jesus will pray, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He's inviting his disciples to begin to realize that God's kingdom is already beginning here and now. We live not with 2 feet in God's reign, but with 1 foot in that we get a glimpse. The Apostle Paul would say in 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, he would say, we see dimly as in a mirror, but then we will see fully. In this moment, if we can lower our sense of self-worth and check our ego and not need to compete or to win, we can begin to see not how the world sees, but as God sees. For theirs, those who are poor in spirit, is the kingdom of heaven. We can begin to live there right here and right now. Jesus goes on to kind of deconstruct how the world sees things as cursed situations, and he sees the inherent gifts and blessings. The second beatitude is very powerful. Jesus says, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. See, it's hard to say happy are those who mourn. I don't want to weep. I don't want to be in grief or to mourn. But if you've ever experienced trauma or loss or grief, Jesus is saying in the mourning, there is comfort. God is a God of comfort. God comforted the people of Israel. The prophet said, comfort, O comfort your people, O God. God does the comforting. There's a beautiful part of Jewish tradition when someone experiences a loss, even till today, it's called sitting Shiva. That if you have ever had a Jewish friend or know of this tradition, when someone loses a loved one, there's a seven-day period where friends and family can come to the house and bring food and sit. Not get anything done, not do any task, sit. The person who's grieving wears black. It's permission. Permission to grieve. Permission to feel feelings, because in embracing grief, there is inherent comfort. People can surround us and God can be our comforter. For an entire year within Judaism, when someone has lost a loved one, at every holiday service, there is a little portion in which the mourner's Kaddish is prayed. So if you have lost a loved one in that whole year, there's a prayer time just for you. Blessed are those who mourn, because God wants to be in that moment. Think about this. These are instructions for the disciples who are about to go out for a three-year mission and travel. Jesus knows they're going to encounter people, widows who have lost their spouses and lost their social standing, parents who have lost children to war, people who are dealing with illness. Jesus is teaching his disciples not to see those people as outcasts or people to avoid, but instead those that God is at work in their lives. They are blessed. Ashrei. There is a fortune in them because God has not abandoned them. The blessings go on to bless the merciful and those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Here there's a juxtaposition between mercy and justice. Mercy without justice is soft, but justice without mercy is too hard for a society. And Jesus wants his disciples to seek what is right for people, but also to show forgiveness and a way forward, mercy. These are instructions for any who want to follow Jesus. We have to be merciful, but we also have to seek right relationship with God and right relationship for others. Jesus goes on to say, blessed are the meek, and blessed are you when you are persecuted for doing what is right. Jesus says, for my sake, for righteousness' sake. Because he wants the disciples not to give up when they lose the support of their friends. He wants his disciples not to bag it all up when they seem to fail in the eyes of the world. But he wants them to hang on for the wild ride of living into the kingdom of God right here and right now. I think in this moment in time where we are living in an unprecedented reality, Jesus' masterclass found in the Sermon on the Mount is just the medicine that we need. It does not side on the right or on the left. It does not align agendas, but it carves out a different way forward. It carves out a way in which Jesus encourages us to practice piety, but to do it with humility. Jesus encourages us to practice compassion, but also to seek justice. Jesus encourages us to align our priorities, to pray for our enemies, to forgive, to change the way that we live, not to align in camps or in parties that are human-made, but to align our hearts and our minds and our feet with the kingdom of God already beginning here on earth, even though we may only see dimly. Now, as we walk through the Sermon on the Mount, if we look at it like a class, like a college class, where a professor walks in the door, gives a lecture, and then offers a test, I have to say, more often than not, I would fail the exam. But Jesus isn't a professor who walks in and walks out. Jesus is a rabbi who lives with his disciples. They see how he lives. They see where he goes. They walk with him. They learn from the rhythms of his life and the tests. They get a second and a third and a fourth and a fifth chance every day to realign their principles. When we follow Jesus, it's not about being right or getting it right all the time. It is about the trying. It's about getting back up and helping others around us back up and to follow the teacher, the rabbi, the one who shows us the heart of God. I invite you today to renew your commitment, not to be a Christian, not to believe this or that, but to be a follower of the one who can show us God's reign already beginning here on earth. Know that you won't always get it right. Some of the things that he offers are hard. It is difficult to put these into practice. But if we can commit ourselves and renew our commitment, that's why we celebrate communion in the Christian church, because we are reminded that we always need grace. We always follow the teacher that says, you had a hard time yesterday, that's okay. Get back up and I'll show you the way forward. As we go into this unknown time, many uncertainties, many divisions, many difficulties, many complications. If we follow Jesus, we are in good hands, but we can't do it alone. We need each other. We need community. And today we are finding and creating that community in many ways, in many new ways. I'm glad you're a part of it. Let's continue by beginning this week to see the blessedness around us. But next week, we're going to see the substance of faith put into action that Jesus shows us. Will you walk with me? Join me in prayer. Oh God, we give you thanks for your heart, that you show us your vantage point on this earth, not in terms of winners and losers and right and wrong and right and left, but God, in those who seek to see your blessings despite difficulties, despite failures, despite our own loss of control, God, you can work and you can make broken things whole again. Work in us, strengthen us, and help us to follow the living Christ, we pray. Amen and amen.
Time full of war, be peace. In a time full of doubt, just believe. Yeah, there ain't that much difference between you and me. In a time full of war, be peace.
In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, make it right.
Life is but a breeze, you better live it. In a place that needs to change, make a difference.
In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, make it right. Oh, don't hide it in the dark, you were born to shine. In a world full of hate, be a light. La, la, la.
La, 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 la. like holy water. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of the symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water.
Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. I'm grateful for us to hear the good news that God cares and God sees and God blesses our broken heart. And I pray you during the week, you experience God's blessings, transcending our understanding to be the blessing in the places it is needed. And I hope you are inspired, encouraged, and motivated by the Spirit. And so God bless you, and I hope you have a good week. See you next week.
Your forgiveness is like sweet.